For inviting me to this exciting meeting, and as the title states, I'm a developmental biologist working on heart development for my entire career. And so what I will try to do is to give you some insights into what we think how the heart actually develops. It's certainly a quite complex process, and also it starts very early on in life, particularly in higher vertebrates. The cardiac myocyte lineage is specified shortly after gastrulation, which is the birth of the different germ layers in the embryo. So depicted here is the situation in the chick embryo, which is a widely utilized model in early heart development. And you can see here in red the two heart fields. This is mesoderm that is now specified to become the precursors of the heart organ. And so these two heart fields are sitting on the left and the right side of the midline, and cells have just shortly migrated out from the primitive streak, organizing in these two islands of cells. And then these cells migrate anteriorly, meet in the midline, and then gradually forming a tube-like structure. And this is a first functional unit, the heart tube, which is a linear tube-like structure, which then starts to pump blood, and this is the first time that the organ becomes functional. Certainly, it doesn't look like a mature heart at this stage, and certainly a lot of different morphogenetic processes have to take place to transform this primitive blood-pumping structure into a four-chambered myocardium. And one of those processes is shown here, which is the beginning of heart looping, which is a transformation of this linear heart tube into a different anatomical situation. One of the traditional views of early heart development is that this process is finished by this early stage period to specify the different parts of the future myocardium. And I've depicted this here by putting different colors in this early heart tube. So the concept, the traditional concept was that this linear heart tube already is a miniature version of the mature heart. So this area here in yellow represents, in this traditional view, the atria. The green area here represents the traditional view of the left ventricle, the blue area the right ventricle, and the red the outflow tract. This concept is still in the textbook, so if you look into the anatomy textbooks and also in certain reviews, you will find this kind of traditional view, but it's proved to be wrong. It looks like that the early heart tube only represents the precursors of the left ventricle and part of the future atria, but all the rest of the organ is actually formed subsequently to this stage. And to make this clear, I would like to have the next picture, because without that, it's very hard to make it clear. I mean, I see it, and you guys are seeing it, but the public doesn't. So. Oh, there we are. So the point is that from this traditional view, we had only one single heart field and everything is formed in one process. But this is the wrong concept. It looks like that the heart is formed in several steps. Gradually, new cells are added to the myocardium, making it more and more complex. And these different cell types actually also interact between each other and thereby adding additional complexities and generating the mature myocardium. One of these concepts is that actually the heart field is divided into two pieces, the primary heart field, which is labeled here in blue, and the second heart field labeled here in red. These two terms have been discussed widely, and also there are some conflicts involved in this interpretation. But what it means is that the blue part of it is the area that differentiates first. So, I mean, all what you see in this primary heart tube, which is formed initially, is myocardium that is derived from this blue area. The myocardium labeled here, the myocardial heart field labeled here in red, is myocardium that does not participate in the initial formation of the heart tube, but it's added later. And so there's an area shown here, which I'm circumscribing here, which is an area of stem cells that gradually are specified to become cardiac myocytes and are added particularly to the anterior part, to the anterior part of the growing heart tube. To make this more clear, maybe the next slide will help you. This is now a depiction of this process in the chick embryo done by my colleague Jörg Menner from the University of Göttingen. So initially we have this very simple and small heart tube, which is derived by the primary heart field. Now additional precursors are centered around here in this area, and then they are gradually added towards the arterial pole, so you gradually get new myocardium added to this heart, and and thereby the whole field, the whole heart lengthens, but it also generates new types of myocardium. So, for example, the entire outflow tract and also the right ventricle are derivatives of the second heart field, and only the left ventricle originates from the primary heart field. This process can be also visualized here by some immunohistochemical staining, now with a marker that labels differentiated myocardium. And so you can see here that the central part of this heart tube shows strong staining for this differentiation marker, while both at the venous and venous inflow tract and the anterior outflow tract, both are unlabeled. So here is additional myocardium added, and because this has still to undergo further steps of cardiac differentiation, at this stage there's no labeling. And gradually this part acquires now the expression, and so you see that particularly the anterior part, there's a gradual addition of myocardium, and this generates the right ventricle and the outflow tract. But the same process is also going on here at the venous part, so gradually the atria are generated and subsequently also the sinus venosus is added. So the heart gradually matures and grows and new cells are added to it. And here in the final row we can show you there are two markers here with myocardium and CFC. These are two markers that are labeled the immature stem cell-like areas of the heart fields, and you can see that both at the arterial and the venous pole there is labeling for this marker, while the actual heart tube itself is unlabeled. So there are clearly two growth centers at the anterior and posterior part of the heart that are generating additional myocardium that is added to this growing organ. And recently there has also been the concept that there is an additionally third population of myocardial cells which are particularly transcriptionally very distinct from the primary and second heart field precursors. And this is this population of cells here shown in blue, which is called the posterior heart field. And it's molecularly distinct, expressing certain transcription factors like TBX18, while other transcription factors present in the primary and second heart field, like NKX2.5, are absent in this population. And this posterior heart field generates then the sinus venosus and also participates in the formation of the sinus node. So this is still another important population. And it's the last to be added to the growing heart tube. So what are the driving factors that specifies different heart precursors? Shown here is again this early heart fields. And then if we section this embryo, then we get this kind of picture here, showing you the situation with the cardiac precursors localized around here. And what should be made clear out of this is that the underlying endoderm, which I'm now marking here, the endoderm of the of the forming foregut is in very close contact to these heart fields. And this intimate contact also plays a very important role because the foregut endoderm is a source for inducing signals that specifies the mesoderm to undergo a cardiac differentiation. So this is shown here again in colored version. So here's the primary and second heart field, and underneath is the endoderm in direct contact. To demonstrate this function of the endoderm in the chick embryo, you could do, for example, simply an excision of the endoderm, removing the endoderm and then asking what happens to the heart-forming fields. If you do that, you can cut out a little piece of tissue here and then culture the embryo further. Then what you can see is here is a staining for a cardiac marker gene, NKX2.5, and you clearly can see that this gene is then gone. It's not present. And the reason for it is because the endoderm secretes all the important factors, all the cocktail of inducing factors required for this gene to be activated. And here's a summary of the knowledge that we are currently have for this process. So clearly, the endoderm is specified here by itself by a certain set of transcription factors entitled SOC17 and HEX. And these lead then to the secretion of growth factors like fibroblast growth factor 8, like BMP2, and wind antagonists like the Cerberus protein. And also signaling molecules like Sonic Hedgehog and Nodal have been identified, all of them playing in at different time points and at different levels an important function to drive a mesoderm into the cardiac lineage. At the same time, there are also antagonistic signaling molecules that are mainly derived from the midline that block the specification and thereby position the cardiac mesoderm just in this area of the embryo. So far we have only talked about the area of cardiac myocytes, the primary and second and posterior heart fields. Those are responsible for generating the different cardiac myocyte lineages, so the atrial and ventricular myocyte lineage as well as the nodal myocytes. Some of them are then subsequently differentiated again into ventricular chamber myocytes and Purkinje fiber cells. And there's also another cell type that is a derivative of the primary heart field, and these are the endocardial cells that form the inner tissue of the myocardium, but are also involved in generating the heart valves. But clearly, we're still lacking a certain fraction or a major fraction of cells that are present in the mature heart. So think about the coronary artery system. That is not a derivative of those cells that we have so far described. Those cell types are generated by a different population of cells sitting here as a small ball of tissue at the venous inflow tract, the so-called poepicardium. There's an additional, and most of what I will talking from now on will be on this cell population, but before I do this, I will also introduce the cardiac neural crest cells, a population of cells that are migrating here from the neural tube into the outflow tract of the myocardium that are involved in patterning the outflow tract and also are involved in generating the innervation of the, to some extent at least, to the innervation of the myocardium. I won't go into further detail into the cardiac neural crest cell lineage, despite that it's very important for heart development, but the rest of the talk will concentrate on the poepicardium. The poepicardium itself is, I think, a very fascinating cell population, given that it generates a multitude of different cell lineages, such as the smooth muscle cells, the endothelial cells, and the fibroblasts, so major cell populations of the mature heart. But they're also proposed to generate blood cells during a certain period in development.
5 minutes remaining.
Yeah. And they also generate the epicardial cells that generate the former, the outer layer of the myocardium. There's also been discussions that the myocardium could have a contribution by the poepicardial cells, but this is still premature to judge. Clearly, these cells are able to generate cardiac myocytes if you stimulate them in vitro. So here's some in vivo live pictures of the situation. So this little ball of cells are the poepicardial cells. Here in a blow-up with a scanning electron microscopy, you can see them nicer, and also here in a section, you can see them, how they make a contact to the myocardium. So this, they have a very peculiar developmental process, because, I mean, they start like a little ball of cells, but then they make a contact to the myocardial surface, crawl on the surface, and cover it up, generating the epicardium. So after having established the epicardium, then some cells again leave this tissue layer and migrate into the sub-epicardial mesenchymal layer and also invade into the ventricular chamber wall, establishing the coronary artery system or also generating interstitial fibroblasts. To establish the fate of the different cells, one could, for example, do a cell transplantation experiment, as shown here, by doing a quail chick transplantation, by taking the epicardium, full epicardium from a quail, transplanting into a chick, and then detecting the quail cells in the transplanted embryo. Then you can see all these brown dots here are labeled then the derivatives of the epicardium. Poepicardium, and this you can see is a quite extensive contribution, and they are migrating in all sorts of areas of the developing myocardium. So where are these poepicardial cells are coming from? It looks like that the poepicardial cells are actually have a common origin with the posterior heart field. And from here on, some cells are specified to become poepicardial cells, while other cells are moving on becoming then a cardiac mesoderm. And this is, for example, visualized here by a double staining done by my colleague Maurice Vandenhoff, where you see the both the poepicardium as well as cells in the myocardium share this red label, which is cytokeratin labeling. And also data from the mouse with different tree lines suggest that both the myocardium and the poepicardium have a common origin. But still, the exact way how the poepicardium lineage or lineages are generated is still an ongoing investigation. And I quickly scan through because I'm already advanced in time. So you have to read all these articles if you want to know this. But one thing that fascinates me, and I want to quickly share with you, is that this poepicardium is actually established as an asymmetric structure. So it's present on the left side, on the right side, but absent on the left side. And this we have investigated quite extensively. But I just share with you also this very nice scanning electron microscopies done again by my colleague and friend Jörg Menner, which clearly show the establishment of this ball of cells, but is clearly only present on the right side, but absent on the left side. And this intrigued us to further analyze the underlying mechanism of causing this asymmetry. And here's just a few more examples of this inherent asymmetry that is present here with different markers. You can see this with multiple different markers. You can see this asymmetry in the venous inflow tract. And we then tested, quickly I have to go through this because the time is completely up. We tested what is the basis of the asymmetry. Underlying is a very complicated pathway involving multiple genes on the the right and the left side, which have been now established. One is the transcription factor. Can you just give me a little bit more time, please? Not much, really not much. I'm skipping. But thank you. It's only we have one speaker less, so I think we're fine. PDX2 is a decisive transcription factor on the left side, and so we tested if we bring this transcription factor on the opposite side where the poepicardium normally develops, does this prevent then a poepicardial development? And we did this by overexpressing this factor, and this green label here represents then that the experiment has worked, and under these conditions we still see only development on the right side. So we interpret this data that this left-sided pathway is not involved in directing the positioning of the poepicardium on the right side. Rather than it looks like that there is a new pathway that has been already established but not implicated in poepicardial development involving the factors FGF8 and SNAIL that are involved in specifying this poepicardium. So if you overexpress FGF8 on the left side, you generate a second poepicardium. Or if you overexpress this transcription factor SNAIL1 on the left side, you do the same thing. So you can actually generate an additional poepicardium on the opposite side that it normally develops. And that's a great thing, at least for me. So to summarize that, so the nodal PTX2 pathway, which is involved in most of our inner asymmetries in our body, is not obviously involved in suppressing poepicardial development on the left side, but it looks like to be a right-sided pathway involving those genes that are mentioned here on the right side that specifies that. So is the chick actually very interesting? I mean, the chick is a bird, and distant from humans, certainly very distant. So just a look into evolution of poepicardial development from the very primitive vertebrates like this lamprey over zebrafish, frog, to the chick. In each of these cases that I'm showing here, the poepicardium is an asymmetric structure. So certainly this is an ancient way of generating poepicardial development by specifying this in an asymmetric manner. Nonetheless, it looks like in mammals it's a symmetric structure. So probably what we see in mammals is an acquired new property, and we still don't know to what importance this asymmetry plays any role in mammalian heart development. The implications for the epicardium are big, and I'm sure that the next speaker may also talk about that, but the poepicardium or the epicardial lineage also has certain important roles subsequent to its development. And one of that is it drives, for example, the proliferation of the ventricular myocardium in during embryogenesis and may have also similar functions postnatally, and this has to be still analyzed. To show you the importance of this cell is shown here by doing an ablation of the poepicardium. You generate a dramatic effect for the embryonic heart. So on the left is the normal heart, and this is the epicardial layer, and underneath is a developing ventricular myocardium, and on the right is a myocardium that is a deficient for the poepicardium, and if you look in the section, you can clearly see that they are the same age, but nonetheless you can see that this looks like a very sick myocardium. It particularly lacks the compact layer myocardium that's very important for ventricular growth. There are many other aspects that I can't cover because of lack of time. There's an implication in cardiac regeneration, particularly exemplified in the zebrafish, where the epicardium plays an important role. And even it could be a home for stem cells. There's a proposition that that the epicardium may be a stem cell niche. And I simply leave it here and simply mention Angela Tollop and particularly Jan Schlüter in my lab and my collaborator Jörg Menner. Without them, all what I've shown you would not be possible. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. This is an outstanding presentation, open for discussion. I have a question from Magdi Yacoub.
Thomas, outstanding, as usual. I have two questions, if I may. One is, how reliable are the markers you use for lineage? How reliable? TBX18, for example, as markers for lineage.
We certainly
100% or when
no,
you...
No, 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 yeah. I mean, certainly, certainly none of the markers I've shown you are bona fide only unique markers. So, I mean, be it TBX18, it's certainly also expressed in many areas in the embryo, and within the myocardium, it's expressed in the poepicardium as well as in the myocardium. In a certain fraction of cardiac myocytes, it's expressed. WT1 is a better marker, and CFC is a pretty strict marker within the heart. So I would say currently we are facing the situation, those early markers share expression with some other lineages, but a combination, if you take a cell and you have a combination of expression of TBX18, WT1, and so on, you're pretty safe. If you rely on a single marker, I think you're in danger.
The second question, if I may, is the origin. We're very, very interested, as you know, in the fibrous network of the heart and the microvasculature. Yes. Are these two things related developmentally?
You mean the
microvasculature and fibrous network? I mean, the fibrous network has more than one origin, is that correct?
I mean, I think the we still lack really a good understanding of all the lineages. What's really going on, I think we only have a glimpse of an idea. I mean, I think we lack the markers. I mean, this is the main thing. We need more markers, do more experiments, and then we slowly, I think, and particularly with regard to the fibroblastic lineages, it's almost nothing is known. So, I mean, I can't answer give you any insight. I don't have any. But we certainly lack an understanding of what's going on, where those cells are coming from. Also, is it a single poepicardial lineage or multiple lineages? I mean, is this ball of tissue a mixture of different cells? Most likely it is, but there's not really an understanding of all that.
Christian.
Thank you very much, Rima Bader. I'm a pediatric and a fetal cardiologist from King Abdul Aziz University Hospital in Jeddah. Just going back to the spectrum of pediatrics, the TBX18 and the asymmetry, I mean, simply because some of the high part stuff is a little bit beyond the clinical sense to sort of grasp. Is there any direct relationship between TBX18 and like hypoplast? Because you're talking about asymmetry, hypoplast right, hypoplast left. And is there like clear cut that we can say that those babies or children will have TBX18? Thank you.
Well, I mean, I would not dare to say something like that. I mean, certainly, I mean, with regard to left and right hypoplastic development, this is probably a misconcept, I mean, because these are probably not related to left-right asymmetry. I think that the heart, with regard to its asymmetry, is mainly a specification of the arterial pole and the venous pole, while the myocardium in itself is actually a product that is generated in an anterior-posterior fashion and subsequently becomes a left and the right ventricle. So I would say TBX18 is not at all involved in that, but I mean, who knows?
Can I ask a question? There is a theory that says that along evolution, we have sort of lost the ability, the heart has lost the ability to regenerate as a trade-off for a greater ability to repair and make fibrosis quickly, for example, after myocardial infarction. Is that something you agree with?
Well, I mean, yes, certainly I would also, this is certainly one of those hand-waving arguments. I listened recently to a talk by a pioneer in regeneration, Dr. Brooks, working mainly on newt regeneration. And I think what he said was probably a better answer. It simply hasn't been acquired. So probably we haven't lost it, we haven't acquired it. So probably what we see in zebrafish is a solution for the zebrafish, and we did not have to do it for some reason or the other. Our heart left it. I mean, probably it's good enough without being able to regenerate it. Unfortunately, we're getting too old, and that's our problem now.
Professor, my question is related to Dr. Olivetto's question. about the embryonic origin of the cardiomyoblasts.
Cardiomyocytes.
No, the niche of cells that has yes. the ability to differentiate
okay.
and proliferate. Mm. So if we know anything about the embryonic origin of these cells. And the second thing relates to the embryogenesis of the coronary circulation. Is there an interaction between the cells driven from the proepicardial organ and the neural crest cells?
Well, I mean, with regard to the, where come those stem cells coming, where are those stem cells coming from? I think nobody knows, I mean, and neither do I, and I haven't done any good experiment to answer this question. There is, what I alluded to was that there is obviously an indication of an co-expression of some of the established stem cell markers being expressed in cells in the epicardium. And so it could very well be that the epicardium is a niche, represents a niche for those cells. Where they are coming from, they're probably born during early development. So, I mean, if we think about the islet 1 cell population, certainly the islet 1 is a progenitor sitting in the second heart field area. And some of those cells obviously make it into the myocardium without being differentiated for some reason or the other. So you can find islet 1 positive cells in the heart. And then the findings, I think what I understand from all those studies is it, they are mainly positioned in those low flow areas, like in the atrium, but it could very well be that they're also homing in the epicardium or coming from there. And I think, again, also in the stem cell field, we really need more markers. And really we need to study what this marker comes from and where is the embryonic origin. Nobody has asked this question. And I think that's where developmental biologists and stem cell biologists have to work together more in the future, because I think we still lack an understanding what kind of cells we are talking about. And with regard to your neural crest question, I think there is no data suggesting that they... Well, they certainly meet... I mean, so certainly they can talk to each other, but I'm not aware of any study studying this kind of particular question that you are proposing. So, sorry.